Okay, guys, I think we are live at the new and earlier 2 p.m. start time. So my thought to start this stream a little bit earlier was because we do have more corals going, and the original idea actually had to do with how dark it gets in the wintertime here earlier. So for a little while, we were, towards the end of the show, it would get very dark, and you get like some weird graphical effects because of the green screen. So, because of that, I tried to think about getting an earlier start time. However, on days like this where it's super cloudy anyway, it's just going to be dark the entire time. So, not really sure if the earlier start time, works out so well for that. But hopefully, having additional corals is always a good thing, so we're not stuck here too late. I will check periodically the chat, try to get a little bit more onto that, and just wait a little bit to allow more people to funnel in to the live show. So, let's see now. On screen, you can kind of see basically how the live sale works. I mean, many of you are live sale veterans, and so you know exactly how things work. But essentially, the live sale takes place in two places. The stream itself is on YouTube, and that's where we show all the different corals. And to actually purchase those corals, you have to go to tidalgardens.com. There is a section all for the live sale. It's like a blinking red dot on the top left of the navigation. And that'll take you to the page where you'll see the entire numbered list of all 170-ish items that we've got going on. What else? We don't ship overseas. I'm looking into that because I get a lot of interest, obviously, about people wanting to purchase stuff from overseas. But as of right now, it is just U.S. only. Shipping is a flat rate, $39.99. So just make sure to include that shipping option into your cart, just like one per order. So if you have like 10 corals with 10 different orders, just make sure that one of those orders has the shipping module. It's a $39.99 thing. But if your total is over $250, shipping is free. And don't worry if you accidentally pay for shipping twice or something like that. It happens pretty much every live sale, and we just go ahead and refund that. So that's how shipping works. Like I said, flat rate, $39.99, free after $250. And you can like mix and match also. So if you want to buy some things from the live sale, plus a couple of things that you were keeping your eye on the regular website, they're just regular items. So you can just toss that all into the same shopping cart and check out just like normal. So there's no special requirements there. Let's see, chat. BJ Nunn, thanks. I've already spent my money for my tank. Yeah. Got a plan ahead. Chris Rogers, welcome. You made it to the live sale on time. And buying coral and watching football. I know which one's more intense. I'll tell you that right now. And it's not the American hand egg game. Oh, is this the last one? I'm eating a lot of candy this morning. Let's see. Yeah, actually, we have a lot of football fans here, I'm guessing. Are you a football fan, Robbie? And Michael, yeah. So, on the camera to start things off, it's going to be Robbie. And in chat right now, who's responding to all the people, that's Michael. And at some point, they're going to flip-flop. Okay, so let's go ahead. Yeah, we could talk about that. So remember last time I had mentioned that I had ordered one of those LED flashlights to try to give like the actinic look, and it just didn't arrive in time. But luckily we have it now, so we're going to be playing around with that just a little bit. At least you can see it, the corals under two different lights. Most of the lights we're using right now are, T5 lighting. However, there's a couple of tanks that have some LED over them. But I tried to get it more towards like the white end of the spectrum rather than like the ultra blue end, just for the camera's sake. But we do have the flashlight that we'll just like toss over the corals just to give it a little bit more of that actinic look. Nick Vincent IV. Nice. This should be timed around tax refund time. That would do some damage. We're going to be pretty much doing it every month, so it'll be pretty much all through tax season as well. And I'm actually looking forward to getting some tax money back too. So I'm trying to save money though. I've been spending way too much money lately. So actually, in chat, if you're feeling like sharing, let me know what you guys got for the holidays. If you got some really 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 cool things or not. All right, let's get started here. The first coral is a tricolor Eulophilia. This is it's a maize brain. This guy's roughly 2 inches, almost 3 inches, and the tricolor is kind of muted a little bit because this particular tank, the first 7 corals I think, is under LED. So let's see what that looks like with the flashlight. Yeah, it's a little bit better. So when you actually hit it with the actinic flashlight, you can see a lot more of the teals and the greens and stuff like that coming out as compared to without. So yeah, that's kind of the look that I would expect to have, like the clear teal, the clear green, the clear purple. Okay. Let's move along. Number 2. This is another variety of tricolor. This one I think has a little bit better coloration. And you can see, like, once we hit it with the flashlight. I'm not going to keep mentioning the flashlight. If you see the coral clearly change color, you can assume that a flashlight hit it. But you can see how the actinic affects things. Regarding anemones, I think in the future, what I'm going to do is take some photos and maybe some short video of specific anemones. And instead of seeing like a live preview like you're currently seeing of the corals, you might just see a short recording. Reason being, we set these corals up the night before. And whenever we did anemones in the past, they would essentially just escape. They'd just run around and we would never even find some of them again. So needless to say, the live sale part plus the anemone part never quite meshed. But what I could do is put like kind of like a representative example of like Amini Maxi or Flower Anemone, things like that. And we can do it on the live sale for a little bit of a discount, that sort of thing. But right now, nothing. Lighting recommendations for Eulophilia. We tend to keep ours in pretty low light. And what I've started to do a lot recently is appreciate the heck out of T5 lighting specifically for LPS. It's not quite so bad for Eulophilia, but like acans and stuff like that color up very dramatically different under different types of lighting. And in my personal opinion, I tend to like the look that they color up to in under T5 more so, like in lower powered T5, not anything crazy. Okay, let's move on to the third coral here. This is a Platygyra. It's a brain worm coral. These guys kind of have a similar appearance with like the ridges and stuff like that as the Eulophilias, except it's a little bit of a tighter pattern. Care requirements are basically the same. However, this coral tends to be a little bit more sensitive. So if you have just a new aquarium or something like that, this might be something you might want to wait for, because older aquariums tend to be a little bit more resilient to fluctuations in chemistry and whatnot. So slightly more challenging. There's no special care requirements. I just think that they need some degree of stability. So auto top off. We don't actually use any type of auto top off system. We evaporate, who knows, 30 gallons a day, something like that. So all of our top offs are pretty, massive, and we just have people here all the time. But there's a bunch of different top offs available. Some people like the Tunzies because they're optical and they're pretty well built. But I know like a bunch of different brands are pretty good. Okay, number 4. Continuing with the Eulophilias, this is the solid purple. Not really sure what the actinic is going to change on this guy. I don't know if he's going to be that different at all. A little green highlights come out. But the majority is purple. So keeping pH. The biggest thing is gas exchange. So a big part of that is kind of continuing to do what you are already doing, is trying to get a lot of gas exchange. The only other thing I can think of is just to get a little bit more frequent water changes. I mean, that's kind of my go-to answer for a lot of problems, but it tends to fix most issues. The other thing is, like, what pH are we really talking about? I mean, I think some people freak out about having a pH of 8.3 or 8.2 or 8.1. That doesn't bother me one bit. So, I mean, unless you're, like, reaching down into the sevens, I would worry. Like mid to high sevens is a problem, because that's what I run my calcium reactors at, is like 7.2. So if your pH is dipping down into that, you're basically dissolving the coral skeletons that are currently living in your tank, and that's not a good thing. Eric Hernandez, first time on this live sale. Any tips? Yeah, if you actually want something, you have to check out with it. Just putting stuff into your shopping cart doesn't work. Real quick, I'll just flash the rules. You're watching, obviously. To purchase corals, you have to go to Tidal Gardens. Flat rate shipping, $39.99. Check the local pickup option. Make sure that you do include a shipping option before you're ready to be all done. And you have to actually check out. There you go. All right, what number are we on? Five? All right, next up, number five. It's another purple Eulophilia, slightly different. A little smaller, or at least it's a different shape. A 7.8. That's a little low. I'll be honest, it's a little low. But oftentimes, tanks in basements and stuff like that, that don't get a ton of gas exchange, run into that issue. 8.3 is what I target, Chris. But then again, like, this greenhouse is basically an outdoor structure, so we don't really run into pH issues at all. Let's see. Number six. Oh, the other thing. It's not a bad idea to make sure your test kit is actually accurate. A lot of times, people have older test kits or something like that, or it's poorly calibrated, and you're just getting, like, wacky results and making changes to your tank based on that, so that's not the greatest thing either. Nick, is it better to keep it on? It really depends. I just tend to keep it on, and eventually it just kind of overgrows. Okay. Let's go to number seven. It's a violet and green platygyra. You can kind of see this guy has his tentacles open. We fed the tanks a couple hours ago, so you might see some of the corals still trying to feed. And yeah, speaking of CO2 and houses, it's almost like the newer home construction that typically has a lot better insulation and it's airtight has like bigger issues with building up carbon dioxide. And some of them are so tight that they actually have to have like what's called an ERV or an HRV, which are energy recovery ventilation units that swap the inside and outside air. So it's like it almost does too good of a job of insulation that you actually have to add technology to make sure that you're not having like just tons of buildup. Okay, so this screen went blank. If you're a veteran of this, that is not an error. We just need to move the entire rig. So that first tank is part of our new system. Eventually, we're gonna have probably about 50 corals in this new system, but we're still waiting on a couple tanks. And when we're moving our little camera rig, we have to cap the camera so it's not too distracting. So no, nothing is wrong. DSB is steep sand bed. So how do I feel about DSBs? Neither here nor there. I mean, do I believe in it as a form of filtration? Not so much. I look at it more as a kind of as an aesthetic thing more than anything else. How should you ventilate a basement tank? The way that I would do it, it's kind of expensive, but I would look into what's called an ERV, Energy Recovery Ventilation System. It looks like a big box that has like this this honeycomb mesh thing, like a cartridge in it. And what it does is it takes air from inside the house and shoots it through this honeycomb to the outside. And at the same time, it's bringing in air from the outside through that same honeycomb, where the air actually doesn't come into contact. But what happens is, like, the temperature of the inside air and the outside air, they exchange heat, essentially. And so the air coming in is kind of like, in the wintertime anyways, it's heated up by the air going out. And so you're basically bringing in fresh outside air, like, all winter long. And it's not killing your energy budget because you are preheating it with the air that's being evacuated out. So that's one way to do it. It depends on the size of the system, like the size of your house. But, you know, they can be kind of pricey, and you also have to get an HVAC technician to install it. Let's see. Can you make a video on fragging and coral propagation? We do have some videos. They're older, so you might have to check out which ones, which corals you're interested in. Steven, what do I do if I want to buy multiple corals? You don't have to pay shipping for each individual one. Just make sure that it's included once, period. So yeah, just go ahead and just check out with, and as a shipping option, select local pickup / live sale. Okay, moving on. All right, so what you're seeing here is a red halo acan. And you might want to make it just a little bit brighter. There we go. Yeah, it's a little bit hard to see the details there. Okay. We've got a few of these acans, so hopefully you like some of them, because some of them are rainbows, like this next one here. So let's go to number 9. And for rainbow acans, lighting is very important in order to make sure that they retain all their colors. You can see under like under the flashlight there how a lot more stuff gets quite a bit punchier. So to show them off, LED is clearly the best. I think to color them up, though, I get better results under T5. Okay, so Sith Rico, do we get what we see on screen, or is there multiples to buy one of each? Okay, so whenever you see like a coral that's just a single one by itself like that, you're getting that specific item. When you see something like, if this said rainbow acan times 5, that means that there's 5 available that roughly look like that. For stuff that's like, I guess, in the, you know, like the $40 range, they're all going to be what you see is what you get. However, there's a couple things like green star polyps or something, you know, like some of the more common stuff that you can pretty much get the gist of it. Those will have multiples, and you might not get exactly what's shown, but I would say that there's less than 10 of those items in this entire auction or entire live show. Most of the stuff is going to be what you see is what you get. Okay, let's go to number 10. This is an Orange Crush Acan Echinata. Acan Echinatas tend to be more flat in appearance. They tend to, they grow a little bit more slowly. And the other thing I've noticed is that when it comes to keeping acans together, you really can't have echinadas next to bowerbankies or Lord howensis's, like that rainbow you saw previously. They sting like crazy, and they're actually very, very aggressive. So if you like these different species of acans, you do have to kind of give them their own space. Jeremy, would you say a hybrid lighting would be the best solution for color and growth? T5 halide or T5 LED? If I had to start a tank on anything, I am a big fan of like the ATI power modules. Like as far as like their build quality, I like a lot, and they have a combination of T5 and LED. All right, next up, number 11. This is the Mystery Center Acan Echinada, and this I expect will look quite good under the flashlight, because all that stuff in the middle starts to get a lot more easy to see. You get almost like this green and orange swirl. And I know this might seem a little silly, but we actually got to triple digits now watching live on the stream. It's pretty cool. Yeah, I mean it's asking a lot of, you know, for people to take time out of their day to watch like a choral show. So it's very cool of you guys. Thank you. Appreciate the support. BJ Nunn, do you keep the rainbow acans in shaded spots? Typically lower light, I would say. So if you actually have a lot of light already in your aquarium, you do want to kind of like find a good spot for them that might be off to the side, kind of like off axis or with a little bit of shade. I've seen them color up the best in lower light. In fact, I mention this quite a lot, but the corals in the wintertime by far look a lot more colorful and a lot more healthy. So you're actually seeing stuff pretty close to peak season. Chris, that flashlight really makes a significant difference. Yeah, I'm actually pretty surprised at how well it works. And greetings, Miss Saltwater Tank. Yeah, earlier start time. Gotta pay attention. All right, number 12. It's a red halo acan. So I'm actually super jealous of Miss Saltwater Tank right now, because in a few days here, she's going to be heading to Australia for, I don't know, like 5 weeks or something like that. And I've never been to Australia. I definitely want to go and do some diving out there. It's a long time to be out there, so that's very cool. I'm jealous of everybody that's going to be going on vacation, because I kind of miss being on vacation myself. I'll just leave that right there. All right, number 13. We have an orange and green acan. This guy has almost like a mustardy color. It's pretty unique from all the other ones that we've got. Gerald, when does the SPS start? About 37-ish. We have a lot of random Acropora. Actually, we have a lot of SPS on this auction. I'd say it's not an auction, it's just a live show. It looks like we have about, 60 at least. Okay, number 14. Little rainbow acan here. This guy's sweet, especially once we hit it with a flashlight, because this guy, I remember, yeah, there you go. A crazy pattern. Rainbow acans in general, I like a lot. I wish, I wish we had more of these. The reason why we don't have more of these is because people buy the hell out of them. So, gotta take the good with the bad, right? But I would love to have like a huge farming section that just focuses on this, but they tend to get purchased up faster than we can grow them. We're trying. Okay, number 15. Okay, so this guy here is a gigantic rainbow acan colony. And we've had this guy for a while now, and it's one of the reasons it barely even fits on the screen. It's got, I don't even know how many polyps. The polyps are huge, the polyps are dividing, and the colors of this guy are just out of this world. So if somebody wants it, it's $450. If nobody buys it, I am perfectly okay just keeping it, because that's one of my favorite Acans, period. Okay. Next up, number 16. Still keeping on with the Rainbow Acans. Moving on. It's one of the lower priced Acans. It's an Incredible Hulk. It's that kind of a green and white. Chris Rogers, what's the dimensions on that? I would say that like the really, really big guy was 5 inches maybe. It's in that ballpark. It's obviously pretty extended right now. Yeah, at least over 10 heads. Somebody on email was asking about whether Fauna-Marin LPS pellets help with growth and coloration. It wouldn't surprise me much if they really helped with growth. We need to be more consistent here with how we're feeding, because it's hard for me to tell whether something is really being affected by food or not, because there's other things that happen here in a greenhouse that's has a lot more of an effect. For example, the change of seasons will have way more effect than anything that we're feeding corals. So it's kind of hard for us to determine just because there's so many other factors. But you know, in general, we've noticed that a lot of them respond really well to Fauna-Marin LPS pellets. So yeah, I mean, I think that that's certainly a good option to try. Dan, what salt mix do you currently use? We use Omega C. Almost nobody uses it, but it's like an Ohio company, and I use it because it's extremely convenient. Because they're actually, they bring it right to my door, like pallet quantities of it, and I appreciate that. So, for some reason, salt is hard to order. I don't know why. It's always been an adventure. Okay, number 18. It's another rainbow. Was that the question that needed answered, Michael?
Salt.
I'm trying to get a little bit better about answering questions in chat. I know some people get left hanging, and I feel bad because I don't see it. Okay, moving on, number 19. Yeah, I'm actually glad that we got one of these flashlights. It's really, I think, adding quite a lot to the show. It's a lot easier to see. And there's Robbie dropping things. Okay. So, again, screen goes black. It's because we're moving the rig. Austin, my scalemia has gone from looking awesome to terrible in a single day. Other than low flow, what is a scalemia special needs? When something just crashes like that really quickly, the first thing I think of is something was actively biting it. So I would kind of like worry about that. The other thing I would think about is like nitrates. Sometimes like a nitrate spike can cause like a coral just to either recede or look absolutely terrible. Things like that. Shifty, do you have clams in this auction? No, I don't. It's been a long, like a really long time since I've had clams here. The way that we do maintenance and whatnot, clams are really unhappy, so they don't tend to stick around long. So either they get purchased or they don't just kind of fizzle out. But yeah, when we get clams, you'll see. They're nice. All right, is that number 20 right there?
Yes.
Okay, let's move on to 21. Okay, so this is actually the second largest acan colony we're selling. It's got some cool pinks and some greens and reds as well. Very cool. All right, number 22. This particular acan, we've actually been growing under a little bit of LED for a long time. So the colors that it took on is a lot more yellow. A lot more of the yellow got accentuated. But I expect some more of like the reds and the purples to creep back in under T5. So this one has been in this tank, which is T5 dominated, for about a week. And like I mentioned before, when it comes to certain LPS, like acans especially, acans, micromusas, that sort of thing, some other of the brains, maybe a little bit even with like the maize brains, you do get color shifts from the type of lighting they're kept under. So yeah, you're going to kind of have to dabble a little bit, and you can expect some degree of color change with these guys. Yeah, I was looking at that. So fighting ick in a reef. What I would do is might not be something that would work for you is I would add cleaner shrimp. But if you have like a lot of wrasses, those shrimp might just get picked off. But wrasses in general don't usually get ick. They have like an extra slime coat that helps them fight that off. You can try garlic. But there's a bunch of anecdotal stuff. The biggest concern that I have is like a lot of solutions. You pretty much have to remove the fish because anything that you would add in there would also kill the coral. All right, let's move on to number 23. Acans are expensive. Well, they come in expensive. So unless you're growing them for a long, long time, which also is not that cheap if you think about it, they come in and it's actually pretty common for nice colonies of acans to cost triple digits at the wholesale level. And if it's a really nice, really large one, wholesale, it could be over $1,000. Just to give you kind of an idea of like some of the cost structures out there. It's one of the most expensive because a lot of them are coming from Australia, and pretty much anything coming out of Australia versus like Indonesia, it's going to have like a higher price tag. Let's see. Reval 28. We do have Zoas today. They're okay-ish looking. There's some nice Zoas, but some of them weren't open this morning, so hopefully they're towards the end. So we'll see how many of them are cooperating once we get there. Okay, so number 24. We've got some of these small micromusas. So acans and micromusas, they look very, very similar, but they are different genuses, genera. Typically, micromusas are a little bit smaller, and I think that they change color quite a lot more aggressively than the acans. So, somebody was asking earlier, are you going to see what you see is what you get? This one, the first person who orders it will get this one. Second, two, will be getting something very similar. About three or four polyps. Nitrate's going out of control. So you shouldn't be getting that after 50% water changes. So what I would be looking to do is just checking your nutrient export in general. You know, is your skimmer working properly, that sort of thing. Because it's actually hard to keep really, really high nitrates, to be perfectly honest. You can dial back on feeding just a little bit, that sort of thing. Make sure that uneaten food is being taken care of. Make sure there's no dead animals just like sitting in your tank rotting. Just that sort of thing. But yeah, if you're doing a lot of water changes, it's actually pretty uncommon for you to continue to have that nitrate spike. The other thing that I would probably also do is to try to remove any detritus that you find. For some reason, that might be getting metabolized back into the water somehow, which is also really uncommon. But if you can remove some detritus, that might help as well. Just some things to consider. Okay, number 25. It's a larger UFO Micromusa. And there's three of these available. Austin, I've heard that leathers release toxins that affect LPS and SPS. Do you personally house leathers in your tanks? Yes, I do. And in fact, we have them in SPS tanks, and honestly, some of the SPS in those tanks are doing better than in other tanks. Having said that, yes, it's absolutely true that leathers do release toxins that affect SPS and LPS. How much of an issue will it be in your system is going to depend a lot on your system. Fact of the matter is we have a large water volume. We aggressively skim. We do a lot of water changes. Like, all those things kind of play into it. So if you ran an ozone system, or if you ran tons of activated carbon, those are all going to be factors that are going to kind of determine things more so than whether it's just you have leathers, you have SPS, therefore your SPS are going to die. It's not the case. There's a lot of factors into it. But yes, it is true. They do release toxins. In a controlled experiment, if that's the only thing that you're looking at, it will have a negative effect on those. But practically speaking, you can design around that and have it be not an issue at all. Next up, number 26. This is a kryptonite candy cane. These guys fluoresce really bright under actinic. All right. Number 27. It's a little green pinwheel candy cane, bright green center. So candy canes are actually super consistent when it comes to coloration. We keep them under different types of lighting occasionally. They don't really change that much. You can pretty much figure out what to expect from these guys. They grow pretty quickly too. Zoanthids and fragging. That's going to be like a personal aesthetic choice. We tend to propagate stuff a lot just because, you know, we're trying to have a selling operation. But if you wanted to spread them around the tank, just make sure to, like, you know, take some precautions, because you know, it's pretty easy to get into a situation where, like, there's polytoxin and polytoxin poisoning issues. You can read all about that online. It's like a very, very strong neurotoxin that some zoanthids and paleothoa have. So you kind of have to watch out for that. But yeah, as far as, like, you know, whether to spread them around or not, it's very much a personal preference thing. Number 28. Okay. This is a teal candy cane. Anybody have experience running BRS biopellets to help control nitrates? I don't have any experience with it. I've actually never really run biopellets. We messed around a little bit with carbon dosing once. It didn't really do a whole lot for us. Nothing that positive. But I've had two people that I know that use biopellets pretty regularly, or like run ultra low nutrient systems or Zeovit, and they really like it. So, basically, find tanks that use that you really like their results, and see if a lot of their practices work for you. All these tanks are going to be very different, so you kind of have to look at it as an entire system together, and then kind of like and just play with it yourself. Okay, number 29. It's a green Indonesian frog spawn. Green tip, I should say. Gareth, how would I successfully attach an LTA to the bottom of a tank? They kind of just burrow by themselves. I never really had to do much of anything to encourage them. So, the Indonesian Euthylia, like the hammers, torches, frog spawn, I find that they grow a lot more quickly than the Australian varieties. And it's personal preference as to which ones you think look better. There's certainly some stars on both sides, the Indonesian and the Australian, so I'll leave that up in the air. But there's no question about which one grows faster. These guys, you can even see a little bud on the bottom left of this guy. So they just add additional heads very quickly. Okay, next up, number 30, is a neon green Australian hammer. It's almost looking yellow, but definitely fluoresces green. When it comes to like alternative filtration schemes, using bio pellets, that sort of thing, the stuff that interests me the most right now are continuous water changing systems using multiple dosing pumps, as well as stuff like the zeolite stuff is kind of interesting to me, but I'm not sure what kind of results that I could get from that. And once you get into larger systems, I'm not really sure how well that works. There's also people that are running their water through some professional water testing equipment. And it's usually like $50 to get a test, and it's a lot more refined, I guess, than our typical hobbyist level kits. And you can actually see trace element per trace element, which ones you would have to add. So that kind of interests me a little bit as well. So I know that I forget what's the company now. I'm sure somebody will toss it in the chat. But I know that Fauna Marin, when I talked to the owner, he was also talking about starting a lab that also provides that service. Shoot. I'm getting old. I can't remember stuff like I used to. Triton Systems or something like that. They do one of those test kits. Testing. I think it's like a liquid chromatography. Okay, so this, what you see on the screen here, is a gold Indonesian hammer. It's kind of like the best of both worlds. You get the fast growth, and you get premium color. Arturo, besides light and a skimmer, what other components are essential? I would say water changes. In some form or another. Okay, let's move on. Number 32. This is a purple Indonesian hammer, and you can actually see some buds at its base. So it's definitely coming along. There we go. Lots of buds. One, two, three, at least six, five, six buds. Okay. Next up, number 33, is the first of our three elegances that we're going to show. Yeah, cool. Kessels. Kessels are nice. They're one of the few LED companies that actually manufacture their own LEDs. You know, of all the lights in here, we actually don't run Kessels. We run some Ecotech, we run some Aqualumination, there's some Reef Brights, there's a few different types of fluorescent fixtures. But no, we haven't run Kessels. We did run Kessels when we were at Macna, and they're pretty good. I know a few people that have those and like them. Okay, number 34. It's the second Australian Elegance. He's a little flat looking right now. But they're both roughly the same. They're all roughly the same size, about, you know, 3-4 inches fully extended. The thing I like about Kessels has to do with their build quality. I think that a lot of their components are sealed, so they're actually very water resistant. And that's kind of important for a facility like us, where there's like a lot of humidity, and there's some chances that like the greenhouse itself might just drip onto a light. So yeah, you would expect that I would give Kessels like a more of a look, but I haven't yet. Shifty, where should elegances be placed? I've heard sand and the rocks both. You can do either or. I've done both. In fact, currently they're all sitting on plastic plates here, so they don't seem to care one way or another that I've seen. Yeah, so the person that has the tank with the Kessels that I did the video on, his name's Will. So if you just did a search on YouTube for Will's tank, you can probably find it. It's a smaller aquarium, but he's also upgrading to something really big, like over 300 gallons maybe. So once he starts getting into that build, I'm probably going to go take a look at it at some point. Number 35. Last of our little elegances on the show. Yeah, and there's like a huge Ghaniopora in that vid. And the funny thing is, he got that Ghaniopora here. And the Ghaniopora that we have of that variety here don't do nearly as well. So it might be a combination of light, but it also might be he's doing a lot with biopellets and with Zeovit now. Okay, 36. We're going to be moving the camera. Best LEDs? I don't think there's really such a thing, to be perfectly honest. We've kept a lot of different anemones under much worse light than that, so... Yeah, you might get some good results. It's kind of tough for me to say. Do you feed your Ghanis anything? Not really. A lot of our corals, to be perfectly honest, are probably a little on the neglected side if you look at any individual one. So this coral here is a rainbow pectinia. This is the only pectinia that we have on the live sale today. But these guys are pretty spectacular LPS. Yeah. We haven't used a PAR meter in a very, very long time. But when we did, a lot of the tanks that were very successful had less than 100 PAR. So if you're looking for something, you know, an idea of how to tune your LEDs, I like the blue look, so I keep those close to 100. And I keep the whites closer to 30. But that's just how I typically set things up. Yeah, different corals have very different responses to light. So just saying like blank coral likes blank light might be overly simplistic. There might be a lot of nuance there depending on exactly which variety it is. All right, moving on. I have a bunch of Acropora that I don't really know the names of. So I'm not gonna try. There's going to be a lot of Acroporas and prices. So Acropora, believe it or not, are actually starting to look pretty decent right around this time. Whether or not they show up on screen that way, tough to say. But during the summer, we lose so many Acropora. It's not even funny. It's like all the random acro eating things start coming out of the woodworks as soon as it's springtime, and it just continues all the way to the start of fall. So it's only like about 4 or 5 months of the year where Acropora even look remotely okay. Are you shipping to Canada? No, we are not, unfortunately. Only shipping to the US. Do you have any custom DIY LEDs like the Crees? I do not. Nope, all my stuff is name brand stuff. 38. Another Acropora. So Robbie brought over all these candies, and I just can't stop eating. Just like everybody else, seemingly, I need to get into the gym, and I'm having the hardest time. So one of my guys that works here part-time is named Sean, big muscle-bound dude, and he's actually a personal trainer. And it's like, if I can't get back into shape when I have a personal trainer on staff, this is like, I need a life-changing event here, because something's got to happen. I need to get back in the gym. All right, so let's go to 39. Do you feed anything special to promote polyp extension in acros? I don't know. But there might be something that would help with that. I just don't really know off the top. A lot of times, polyp extension has more to do with stuff bothering the coral than the coral reacting positively to something else. In Nathan's tank, for example, his acros grow like crazy, practically out of the water. Problem is, he has no polyp extension because he has one of those filefish that constantly picks at the polyps. So the corals themselves are healthy. Polyp extension, not so much. Mr. Silent, 937. We need to get together so I can come see you. About to do another 125 build. If you need a 125, I'll sell you a 125. We're in the process of reworking some of our systems. So we actually have like 125-gallon tank available. All right. I need those lights for my face. All right, number 40. It's one of the larger pieces of acro. Nice purple tips on that guy. Is it an Acropora echinata? You know, here's the thing. Acroporas are by far the best documented at the species level. So there's over 100-something species. It's really, really, really tough to tell many of them apart. And you're actually supposed to look at their skeletons once they're dead under like a microscope to really determine stuff. It's a bit crazy. So when somebody says, oh, this is an Acropora tarraki versus an Acropora echinata, it might be. But there's a really good chance that it's incorrect. This isn't that much of a science outfit. we talk a little bit about it when it comes up. I mean, for example, you know, I've got friends that do work in biology labs that are doing research on this stuff, like the zoas and pallies, octopi is not a word, I found out. And that stuff is all interesting, but for hobbyist level stuff, it's a little bit thick in the weeds, so I am not by any means a reference when it comes to Acropora identification. I'm sorry. 41. Genser 184. Finally, it works for Germany. That is very interesting. Because for the longest time, Germany did not allow live streams from YouTube, and it's because their equivalent governing body to like the FCC in America basically considers like a live show a commercial television broadcast or something like that. So you need to actually have a license to do a live program in Germany. So for the longest time, like my German viewers basically had to hack their computers and stuff like that, or to mask the fact that they're watching a live show. And that's the only way they were able to find it. So I don't know if something else happened over there in Germany where the laws changed or something. But yeah, that's actually quite interesting that Germany specifically has opened up a little bit. Unfortunately, you can't buy anything, but I'm glad you're here. A golden maxima clam? Lighting for clams in general. Let's just go with that. They need very bright light. Very bright light. I think that the people that I've seen that have had by far the most success, you're talking 250, 400 watt halides. I would start with that. Okay, what number are we on? Are we...
42.
Okay, so...
I'm going to
42. Okay. So this is, again, going back to, you know, what is this? This could be an Acropora Taraki. That's what it was sold to me as. It also looks like an Acropora Echinata. So I'll let you guys decide. All right. Let's go to number 43. So this particular Acropora, strangely, is kind of like a teal color on screen. Is that teal color in person? Kinda. Yeah. Yeah, kind of peach without the actinic and more teal with it. Greetings from the Netherlands. I'd like to come visit. I want to visit a lot of Scandinavian countries in the near future, particularly Iceland. Yeah. All right, moving on, number 44. Chris Rogers, any bird's nest coming up? Yeah, there's like two. So I better jump on that if you want one. Okay, number 45. So these are, I think technically they're red dragons, but there's something about this particular guy that's kind of interesting, is that the tips are starting to get a little bit yellow. They actually have like yellow fluorescing tips, which is kind of not very red dragon-ish. It's kind of interesting. Can bleached parts of an Acropora coral recolor? Yes, assuming that it's not actually dying, they do recover. Acropora are, I mean, they're one of the most demanding corals out there that aren't completely impossible. They're just so sensitive to changing conditions, let's call it. Because I was on vacation in Hawaii, like we talked about that during the last live sale and on social media and stuff. And there's a tank that the Waikiki Aquarium has that's outdoors, and it gets blasted by direct Hawaiian sunlight, like as bright as you can possibly imagine, and it's doing super well. And I think it's because it's just very consistent there. It's been getting that light for basically decades. Whereas here, our seasons change so drastically that our summer and winter conditions are so off from one another that a lot of Acropora really struggle. So in your home aquariums, I think a major key is to like lock down on your chemical stability and make sure you're up on your lighting, on your light bulb changes to make sure that you're getting roughly the same light. Because again, I think it's just a consistency issue, not necessarily I need a blank type of light almost. It's like whatever you have, make sure it's very, very, very stable. They're called Pac-Man if it has yellow tips. Mr. Pac-Man. Okay. 47? 46? They're all to label just Acropora, but they do have different prices. Any Ricordia mushrooms? Yes, there are. There's going to be a few mushrooms. No Ricordia Florida, I don't think, though. But Ricordia Yuma. If you can keep a sea star, you can keep an Acropora. Depends on the sea star. Some of those might eat the Acros. Okay, moving along, number 47. This guy's pretty cool. So this is, I forget where we got this guy, but he actually has a sky blue coloration. A lot of times people are looking for some really nice blue corals, so this is definitely one of those varieties. I can tell we've had him for a little while because he's already growing onto the plug. I missed it. What was the question?
I'm not sure exactly what it means, but it says, where is the location of the coral growing center? I was talking about.
How about this place?
Yeah.
If you're talking about Hawaii, it's the Waikiki Aquarium. It's basically, you know, right on the beach in Waikiki. And if you're talking about my place, we're in Ohio.
Is there any blue, or wait, is there any cheap place that you would recommend for us to buy?
Cheap lights. What I would do is to get inexpensive T5s. Reason being, you can always use those later. Even if you do one day decide to get more expensive, like LEDs, you can always use T5s to kind of fill in the spectrum that you might be missing with LEDs. And you can, if you don't even like how they look, the T5s, I mean, what you can do is leave them on while you're at work or something like that on a timer and turn them off when you come home. So you can kind of appreciate all your corals and everything in your tank under LED, but still benefit from the T5. Because one thing, in addition to the spectrum that you're going to be getting from T5, you also get like a more even spread, so you get less of a spotlighting effect that some people with LED struggle with, where certain parts of the corals get shaded and end up dying off because of how, I guess, directional LEDs tend to be, whereas T5s have a very even spread throughout the tank. So if you're just starting off and just want something cheap, get T5s, because they will have much more application in the future. All right, let's move on to number 48. Can I keep a blue tang in a 75? When it comes to keeping fish, I tend to be on the ultra-conservative end, which is, I think, the only ultra-conservative thing about me. But I tend to, like, really hesitate when it comes to tangs and fox faces and stuff like that in smaller aquariums. And what I mean by smaller aquariums is any aquarium. Like, you can see some tangs and stuff like that swimming around in here, but they're here to perform a function. And I don't know if that's a good excuse, because I am being a hypocrite there. But when you see them in the wild and you see just how much they travel, I mean, the idea of putting them in like a glass box that's like 6 feet long or 4 feet long or 2 feet long in some cases, it's kind of messed up. And they die really, really early. You know, they live a really long time in the wild. They tend to not do that in captivity. So, I don't know, I kind of struggle with that a little bit. So, I guess, like, you can do it. It's not my favorite thing in the world to do. And if there was, like, a better thing to take down macroalgae in my systems, I would definitely gravitate towards that over a fox face or a tang. Okay. So what are you on, number 49? Okay. This Acro is actually kind of cool, because he's got like a purple base and has these like little bright highlighter green highlights. What can cause a large drop in magnesium, Wardman? That's a tough one, because there's like this little trinity of alkalinity, calcium, and magnesium that has like this a pretty connected interplay. So it sounds like the buffering capacity of your water somehow just took a hit. Something might be sucking it out of the water directly, because these ions are directly used by corals, directly used by other inverts. So you kind of have to look at all three of those parameters together to kind of get an idea, because just boosting calcium and alkalinity will also kind of cause magnesium to tank a little bit. So it's kind of that interplay between those three. Don Myers, welcome. What did I miss? About 50 corals. So not much. There's still quite a ways to go. I have a colony of zoas, Alex and Susan, that have their necks stretched. They're open, but the tentacles are curled. They sound fine, actually. It's better than being tight and not really doing a whole lot. Devin Skelf, thoughts on Kessel A360? They're pretty good. Pretty good. Number 50. There's the first of our two bird's nests. Let's see. The bioastronaut. Can I keep a pipefish in my aquarium? Depends on the pipefish and depends on the aquarium. We have some dragon face pipefish that have done very well for us. We've also kept other types that have just like died in 48 hours. But our dragon faces we've had for like over a year now. They do really, really well. RC reviews. Can a harlequin tusk live in a 75-gallon tank? I'm going to say no on that. We have one in a 300 and he looks cramped. Yeah, I answered that one. I got that one. Yeah, and the only reason we even have that harlequin tusk is because somebody was taking down their tank and had to give it away. And we happen to have a 300-gallon tank. And I actually wish we didn't have that fish, because that's the only 300-gallon tub that we can't put snails in. And we got like all these Astrea snails. And they've done such an amazing job of completely clearing up these tanks, except for that one that has the harlequin tusk. Yep, no alcohol today, just candy. We'll have to do a Jell-O shot one at some point. Gross. What are we, 15? All right, number 51. It's a bird of paradise. Doomington, have a question about frog spawn. Do they like strong flow? Because they're only semi-open in my tank. I don't think they like strong flow. I've seen them in both low and strong flow, and I think they like medium to low flow. I tend to have a lot better results. It's past 6 p.m. somewhere on the planet. I don't mind being called an alcoholic. I drink at all hours. When I drink, which is almost never. You guys have seen probably half the times I've drank this year. Directly on stream. Alright, number 52. It says the yellow varieties. Tiny little nub. These guys are really slick. Just because they're canary yellow coloration. They do grow pretty slowly, though. And what candy? This is, right here, this is gas station sour watermelon slices. Gas station, Circle K brand. And technically, it's Robbie's candy. He just happened to set it on this table, and it's getting eaten. I guess you have to go to the gym after work with all that candy. Yeah, that's the idea, right? All right, number 53. It's a green Passalapora colony. This guy we have been growing under LED, And so he actually has a little bit of a lime green color going, a little bit of a pink base. So, you know, when it comes to like trying to eat well and stuff, I'm actually pretty good. It's just that other people bring bad food into my presence, and then I eat it all. I'm gonna blame other people for my problems, like my lack of exercise. Okay, let's move on to number 54. I don't know if you guys know what kombucha is, but I'm looking into to making it at home. It's like a fermented tea, which is actually supposed to be very, very healthy. I'm not the biggest fan of its taste, but I actually do feel better when I drink it. So I'm going to give that a go for a little while, see how that works out. Let's see. I've been watching your videos for a while and wonder, what is your experience with clams and any tips to help them thrive? I suck at clams. Absolutely terrible at it. If I were to start from scratch, I would look into just really intense light. I would look at light on rails. And the only reason I would consider light on rails is just so if you have like a 400 or 1000 watt halide, you can just kind of move it along a single one along the track rather than having like six of them. So stuff like that. Yeah, but in general, this is the way that we do maintenance out here. It's not great for keeping those guys, unfortunately. 55. It's a pink Postulopora varicosa. These guys have a slightly different growth pattern. They actually grow like these little knuckle nubs. Yeah, that tea is rough. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about my thought process behind this, behind kombucha, and probiotic stuff in general. So, fun fact time, okay? That half the cells in your body don't actually belong to you. We're actually this walking ecosystem of bacteria that we kind of take overlordship over. So most of, a lot of brain chemistry stuff actually originates in your gut. Like serotonin and stuff, like the gut bacteria has a lot to do with the regulation of a lot of this chemistry. So when you take stuff like antibiotics, it just completely nukes your system. I mean, it's a real drag on your body. So when it comes to like probiotic stuff, you can actually take some of the stuff and literally feel better on a brain chemistry level. So that's kind of why I put a lot more emphasis on stuff like kombucha, stuff like miso soup, a lot of fermented foods, because it tends to really help with the gut flora. So that's kind of the stuff that I'm kind of looking into just a little bit. And I absolutely do feel a lot better after drinking kombucha, like noticeably better. So I guess that goes back to a little bit more of a deeper talk on why we're getting into that. I'm getting into that. Okay. Next up. 56. It's the second, is it second? Yeah. It's our second Postulopora varicosa. Yeah, a little bit of a green going on in the base and lighter pink on the tips. Not really sure on whether it's called a cauliflower or not. I've heard many other corals called cauliflowers, like Dendroneftia and stuff like that, so not so much. And actually, dark chocolate, I think, is also probiotic. So dark chocolate does do something with that as well. What do you keep your nitrates and phosphates at? Probably zero. So some other places have a lot of success keeping their nitrates and phosphates closer to one, but it's really hard to maintain that in larger systems. Yeah, the bioastronaut. Yes, bacteria outnumber the cells in our body. Bacteria make up a good 6 pounds of the average adult human. That and, like, so oftentimes I get into this thought of that, you know, that this is me, this is who I am. But all this bacteria isn't just some silent entity in my own body. It, like, it gets a vote too. And sometimes when I wake up feeling like absolute garbage, a lot of times it's tied, I think, to just, you know, not really providing all the nutrients necessary for all the, you know, for all the bacterial stuff going on in my body. So anyway, I'm very interested in such topics. I'm a big hippie. 57. It's a slightly larger varicosa. Yeah, so I'm blaming Robbie for bringing me candy. I'm blaming my bacteria for why I'm not in a good mood all the time. It's always somebody else's fault. All right, number 58. This is a multicolored Passiflora. It's got a kind of a cream-colored base. It's got purple that kind of terminates into like a bright green. And we have 5 of those available. So roughly you're gonna get something that looks like that. You might not be that exact one. All right, moving on, 59. We have a lot of this stuff. Pink Passiflora, just like the straight pink variety. There's so much of this growing. So that's why it's much lower price point. A lot of them available. You might get something bigger than this. It's basically whatever we can fit in the little containers that we use. All right, number 60. This is a slightly different variety of pink Passiflora. If you kind of look at the way that it looks, more like a bush. It's a much tighter skeleton looking thing. Got 5 of those available. Slight color differences, but not a lot. RC reviews, please view this link and tell me if it grows coral. I can't. So for whatever reason, YouTube chat does not allow allow hot links, it seems. So you might have to get creative in how to post that. All right, number 61. Let's move on. This is a peach stylophora. So stylos compared to Passiflora. I don't really notice any care differences. They're really hard to tell apart. Especially, you basically have to see the two side by side, unless you've seen a million billion corals and you kind of just know on sight which one is which. Very similar looking. You can kind of like scoot back and forth just to kind of see, see which one's which. But I can kind of notice a difference in just like how evenly spaced the polyps are, and the polyps themselves look a little different, but they are very similar. I'm wondering if it'd be okay to put a tank in my grow room. I have an empty corner and I was thinking about frag setup. Thoughts? Your plants aren't gonna like the salt. It's gonna be the other way around. It's like the fish tank is gonna be bad for the plants. We're in a greenhouse right now. Half this place used to be plants. None of them did well because of the saltiness. Yummy sugar. Okay, so this is number 62. It's a larger peach stylophora. Passiflora and stylophora are actually pretty consistent when it comes to coloration. Unlike the acropora, which pretty much change color when like the breeze is different that day. These guys, you can pretty much get an idea of what they're going to be, regardless of the lighting system. All right. Number 63. It's a neon green stylo. And so for those of you who have come late, you might be noticing that the lighting is changing. It's because we finally got one of those LED flashlights to provide a little bit more actinic. So you're seeing this coral right now under T5. And then Robbie's going to put the flashlight over, and that's where you're seeing a little bit more of the highlighting in the actinic range. So that I guess at least gives you two different lighting paradigms to kind of compare what the coral might look like in your system. Okay, number 64. It's another little neon green stylo. And stylos grow at a pretty nice clip. Not super fast, but they're nice. Any blue coral? Got a few. There was the one Acropora that we had shown earlier. He's blue. There might be a Sympodium later that's blue. There might be some other, maybe a Chalice or two. Okay, 65. It's a much larger neon green stylo. What are your thoughts on mangroves in display tanks? To be perfectly honest, I've never kept a mangrove. Oftentimes I see them relegated to sumps and things of that sort, but you do have to realize that a mangrove is like a tree. Like, if you do things correctly, it should turn into a 30-foot tree. So I guess it kind of depends on what your goals are, but if you're wanting to, you know, to use as like a filter of some sort, there's probably a lot better ways than planting a tree in your house, but I know a lot of people that have done it. Where are you located for local pickup? We are in Copley, Ohio. Oh, that'd be funny as hell. Kind of like play that Russian roulette of jelly bean flavors. I've seen some really, really interesting like concepts. So there's like this YouTube channel out there that I just like stumbled upon, where this guy, he like has these hot wings, and there's 10 different flavors of hot wings, going from like extremely mild to nuclear blazing hot. And he has a guest come on, and he asks them one question per wing, and they both eat it. The host and the guest both eat these wings, and they have like hardcore rappers and stuff like that come and answer and are part of this interview thing. And it's so hilarious because it's like the hot wings are like a truth serum. Like when you're in so much suffering towards like, you know, wing 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, there's so much suffering going on, like it totally breaks down people's, like, you know, their public persona. And so the questions, as they progress up the spiciness tree of these hot wings, they get like a lot more probing and personal. So like he's asking this rapper, it's like, so are you in love, you know, that sort of stuff. And it's crazy because like these guys, you know, they can't hold it together because they're just, their faces are burning off, and like you can just see tears streaming down their faces like as they're, you know, going through this. So that, I thought that was a very, very clever concept for a YouTube show. SPS, same genus, sting each other. Yes, they do. I've seen Acropora definitely sting the heck out of each other. All right, let's see. Let's move on. This is a purple stylo. Number 66. Another German. Something must have happened in Germany, I'll tell you. Okay, next up, number 67. It's another purple stylo. Let's see. Maybe three. The other thing you can do is like raise them up higher, but there's some issues with light fall off because of the inverse square law. Let's see. What are the best hardiest SPS corals to start with? Well, you're actually seeing a lot of them. Posilipora, Stylophora, Seriatopora. Little bit like with some Montipora maybe. Let's see, 60 Ocho. It's a larger purple stylo. Yeah, and we did a video and an article for Coral Magazine on easier SPS. Okay. Number 69. This is a pink stylo. Best way to get rid of ick. My favorite is the shrimps. Let's see, number 70. It's a much smaller little pink stylo. And I think we are at our intermission break. I'm going to get some tea and gobble down a few more of these snacky treats. And Robbie and Michael are going to switch positions here, and so we'll see who had the better camera work and who is more affable in chat. Do you guys have any large pieces of the neon green stylo? The one that we had was the biggest one that we offer. We have a gigantic one, but we haven't offered that one up for sale or anything. Okay, like I said, grabbing some tea. Be right back. Sour watermelon slices. What are in these things? Sugar, corn syrup, modified food starch, citric acid, tartaric acid, sodium citrate, lactic acid, artificial flavor, titanium dioxide, red 40, yellow 5, blue 1. Made in Canada.
Titanium dioxide?
Mm-hmm. Gas station food. Let's see. Back from break, we take a nice long break. It's like 2 minutes, because we actually have to swing all the way around to the other side of our system here and get set up again. Okay. So this guy here is a small frag of Scarlet Montipora. You've got 5 of these. You know what? Can we brighten that just a little bit, Michael? Yeah, better. And I'm not sure how this guy fluoresces with the flashlight, but I do know that it has like nice blue centers and everything like that. Okay. Next up, number 72. This is the Forest Fire Montipora. This is a branching variety, if it wasn't already obvious. It kind of has like a more of a greenish base and red polyps. It's almost like looking a little bit bluish in that. Okay. Number 73. This is a kind of a larger piece of green plating Montipora. Was 71. Okay, so 71, Chris, it was an encrusting variety. Let's see, best plants for the refugium. I kind of like just kind of the decorative stuff. So I like stuff like red hex, like that flame tongue stuff, that dragon's tongue flame stuff. And I like codium, which is kind of like the green branching stuff. Where do all the names come from? Most of the time on the other side of the ocean, we don't have the names. I'll just have to do it by color. Well, like stuff like Montipora and stuff, so that's like the actual genus name. All the rest of it, it's either something that we made up or somebody else made up. And I would much, much, much rather use something that somebody else had made up. I always do this rant about naming corals. I detest the process of trying to come up with names for stuff. So we do like a short search to see if there's a name for something, and if we don't find something, then we begrudgingly throw in some name. And that's why we get boring names, like Green Plating Montipora. We don't really get that creative on stuff. Because at the end of the day, I want somebody to be able to search on Google and find it, and find us specifically. So the chances of us making up a name out of thin air, it's less likely. We try very, very, very hard not to make up names. I do not enjoy it. So if you're reading like weird names, it's been made up. And some of them stick, like radioactive dragon eye zoanthids, for example. That's a thing. Eagle eye zoanthids. Like there are certain things that have kind of well established names. Whereas I think other things might have like 10 different names that just random people made up stuff for. So it's kind of all over the place. Okay, next up, number 74. And as far as like, you know, whether I like the names or not, some of the names are actually kind of cool, kind of clever. A lot of them are really kind of dumb. But in some ways, they can actually be helpful. Like, if somebody was to try to describe certain zoanthids to me, I have no idea what you're talking about. But if you said, like, a Fruit Loops zoanthid, I know what that is. Or something like a radioactive dragonite, like I mentioned, I know what that is. Then it gets unhelpful when somebody starts saying, you know, like, really, 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 really weird names. And it's like, well, I have no idea what that is. It's like, we might have something similar. And at that point, it's like, well, do you have a picture? And like, and at that point, the, you know, the naming thing just kind of falls apart. Okay, number 75. This is a red plating Montipora. Do you have a supplier of Zoas from Hawaii? No, I think it's legal. I don't think there's any import or export of corals coming out of Hawaii. And everybody I see in chat is posting their favorite Zoa names. Actually, my favorite ones are the ones that are named after porn stars. And so, like, only, like, the super lonely guys get the joke at all. I don't know. Porn's pretty mainstream these days, so I bet everybody knows exactly what everybody's talking about. Michael, I think it needs to be a little bit darker now. I'm picking up a little bit too much of the white from the bottom. Thanks. All right. Let's move on to 76. The biggest issue I have with names, for example, with Zoas, when some are so close to others that Bowsers and Candy Apple Red, stuff like that. We run into that here a lot, where certain things do look different. They don't look that different. So sometimes, like, I just want to lump these two things together. But then, you know, somebody else is like, no, they really are different. And then within a month, either they can look like the exact same thing, or then they can really start to take off in their own different directions. So sometimes when you see, you know, different pictures of coral, it might be the same thing called five different things. It's kind of hard to determine. So I like to just to get relatively close, and that's good enough. Whereas I know some people are like so set on exactly what something is that they reject all others. That's their prerogative. It was never that big of a deal to me. 77. This is a purple sand dollar, Montipora. These guys are encrusting, but they do form these like sand dollar shapes. Okay. Number 78. This is the Montipora erengi. It's a tiny little frag. Of all the Montiporas, I always thought the erengis and also the setosas, which are more branching than these guys, are so interesting just because of the distance between the polyps is a lot greater. So it kind of has like this unique, unique appearance. They are more of an encrusting variety. Okay. Bioastronaut, who's typing and who's talking? You know who's talking. Who's typing is... What's your name? I'm kidding, it's Robbie. It's the guy that I'm stealing all the food from. I give all my employees and all my, you know, volunteers and stuff a lot of grief here. Oh, and the person operating the camera is Michael. All right, next up, number 79, is a sunset Montipora. Ideally, this guy would have like more orange in the base. So I expect, you know, if this thing had consistent aquarium lighting, it would develop that. The Montipora erengi that we had shown just earlier, those stay very consistently orange. Sunset Montipora can actually have a very, very, very drastically different color depending on the lighting. Okay. Number 80. It's the green Leptosiris. We have 5 of these frags. These are pretty neat. This actually got featured in the recent Coral magazine. There was like a small section on kind of hot up and coming corals or something like that, and then they kind of featured this. I forget which retailer they were spotlighting there. And yes, Chris, the Sunset Montipora is encrusting. 81. This is the Jack-o'-lantern Leptosiris. It's just a small little frag of this guy. Jack-o'-lanterns are the ones that have like the little light greenish yellowish eyes. Is a golden Leptosiris. So you can see right off the bat that it doesn't have like the green around its mouth or anything like that. Oh. I need to stop eating all that sugar. I think my stomach bacteria is about to revolt. All right, and number 83. This is the Ultra Leptosiris. Kind of like the Jack-o'-lantern, a lot more green. And a lot of those greenish streaks actually go all the way out to the rim. So yeah, we have 4 different types of Leptosiris on this auction. And if you didn't already know, Leptosirises are an encrusting coral. Right, 84. This is a meteor shower Cephastria. Strangely, I think if you looked at last time that we've had one of these things, the separation between the red and the blue was a little bit more distinct. And I would have expected it to be more so now, but it's kind of blended kind of evenly. Generally speaking, I expect to see a lot more red and a lot more bluish green. Okay, number 85. Harlequin Cephastria. This is by far the cheapest we've ever offered this. It's because for whatever reason, coming into the winter months, this stuff has just exploded in growth. So usually we charge like 30-something, 40-something for this stuff. But now we have 15 available, $10 each. We're just trying to clear up some space. Chris Rogers, what are the lepto care requirements? I'm not really super familiar with them. I've noticed they do really, really well in low light. I haven't seen them really affected by flow that much. But we've kept some in like really, really low light that have done quite well. Okay, number 86. We have a marbled Cephastria. So these Cephastrias are probably the lowest lighting coral that we have. They struggle incredibly once like spring summer comes along. We probably lose about like 80% of them, to be perfectly honest. Like a lot of them just die out. but you know, we have to kind of find like really dark corners to kind of like stuff them all into that don't get hardly any light. '87. We'll get to that in a second. Yeah, so Fast Year are pretty cool. The coolest ones that we have are some that we just kind of forgot about in one of our smaller aquariums that's kind of like tucked in back. And it grows, it just grows and grows and grows. And then once we finally do come back and look at it, it almost looks like it's taken over the entire rock. And and just they all fluoresce. That's kind of the neat, you know, touch to them. And a lot of them have like a lot of contrasting colors. So when you kind of see all that together, it's a pretty neat look. What can you say about seahorses in aquariums? I've never really kept seahorses. I hear they're very messy to have to feed all the time. They're kind of also kind of delicate and don't have the best swimming technique, whereas like pipefish actually swim a lot better than you might think. All right, so this is the pink Cephastria. And it looks like there's some sort of some worms on the side there. You can kind of see. And at first I was like, is that an Aptasia? But it looks like actually like those, I forget exactly what type of worm those are, but they kind of like grow beside coral sometimes. They have these little active whiskers. Number 88 is an Astrea snail pack. So when I was going through this, somehow I just like numbered right past it. So instead of redoing all the numbers, I just decided to toss in number 88. If you want Astrea snails, they're usually like $1.25. You can get a 20 pack for $20. So there's that. I love them. They've pretty much saved a couple systems here that were just kind of getting overrun with algae. Instead of restarting the systems, we put in tons of these snails, and they've made all the systems pretty spotless. So I'm a huge fan. 89, what you're seeing, is an orange pavona. And we have 5 of these guys available. Okay, let's move on to number 90. This is the Freak Hair Pavona. I'm kind of curious what effect the flashlight will have on this, because I know that the tentacles fluoresce pretty strong. Yeah, you can see a little bit there. Kind of like a lime green fluorescence to it. Sith Rico, are Cephastria good for a beginner tank? Somewhat. They're good in the sense that they don't really require a lot in terms of equipment, because they do well in low light, that sort of thing. But they might be just a little bit sensitive just being stony coral, so you do have to watch out for like the calcium and alkalinity levels and whatnot. It's a good entrance into stony corals if you've never kept them before, but they don't really need any special requirement other than low light, I would say. Okay, moving on, number 91. This is a cobalt Favites. We have both some Favia and Favites, and a lot of times, you know, people ask me what the difference is. Generally speaking, Favites have smaller polyps, grow a lot faster. Favia tend to grow a lot more slowly. Pipefish, we have them in some pretty large aquariums, because you can't really, they don't feed on stuff that I put in the water. They just feed on little tiny creepy crawlies that I can't even see. Like, you can, if you watch them carefully, you just see them picking at stuff, but you don't, it's really, really difficult to see what they're actually eating. I know that they're eating plenty because after about a year and a half or so, they're still here. So that's a good sign. We've got a pair of them. And so I think that one of the keys is to have a big enough aquarium where the like the microfauna is able to reproduce like that. And as far as like pipe fish, the price, they're not that expensive. I mean, I think I got mine from Live Aquaria for about 25, something like that. Okay. Next up, Scarlet and Gray Phyvites. Similar to the cobalt, but he says it has some gray patches in the middle and a red rim. Okay, next up, number 93, is a war coral Phyvites. So the war coral is kind of neat because like the center of the polyp is slightly like misshapen compared to all the other Phyvites. But that stark like red-green contrast is what kind of draws a lot of people to the war coral. Okay. Number 94. This is a blood red Phyvites. Three of these guys. So, you'll get something similar to that. We're actually making pretty good time. It's almost 4 p.m. here. So we're just getting into 2 hours. Pretty good. Next up, number 95. I'm not sure if this is the correct name or not. We may have used a different name in the past, but we're calling this an Orchid Flavia for the purposes of this show. These guys, they do grow a bit more slowly than a lot of the Phyvites that we've shown earlier. But, you know, you can feed them. And I've seen, like, a lot of like the Prism Favias from Australia grow much more slowly than these guys. So, they don't have quite that drawback. Yeah, and Daniel, I think within the first 20 or so corals, we had a lot of acans. I think you can scrub back in the YouTube stream. Okay, number 96 is the red and green Phyvites. So when's the next drinking stream? I'll make my schedule fit. So I always say that like I don't drink a whole lot, and then I'll follow it up with a story about when I did. So recently, a friend of mine came in from out of town, and we went to this place up in Cleveland called the Velvet Tango Room, and it's like this really old school speakeasy type place. They play like jazz music and stuff like that. It's like really comfy in there. And they have some like crazy martinis. And, you know, I was never a martini person, like, because I've had bad martini experiences. Not that I drank too much. They just never tasted good or anything like that. But this particular place is like super old school. They handcraft like everything. So they make their own bitters. They make their own vermouth, all that stuff. So when they make a drink, it's like pretty on point. So, and they make like historic drinks, like that date back to like World War I and stuff like that. And when I had a few of their drinks, it was like the most incredibly delicious drink that I've ever had. And it's like 100% alcohol practically. So And the weird thing about it is, if you actually have like good alcohol, you don't get sick the next day. So I swear, like after going to that place, the next time I woke up in the morning, I've had worse hangovers from eating too salty of food. And you know, I had like, I don't know, 2-3 drinks of just these martinis, which is like a ton for me. Cause considering like I feel it after like the first 2 sips, but those cocktails were like amazing. Anyway, again, I don't drink that much. 97. Let's move on. So this is the Dragon Soul Favia. These guys are pretty cool. I like they kind of have the triple color going on, but these guys do grow very slowly. Don Myers, any Blastos? We have a few. No Dendros, but we do have Blastos on this particular sale. I'm wondering if you fed these guys very aggressively, if they would grow faster. Again, we kind of broadcast feed a lot. We don't do a ton of individual polyp to polyp feeding, but I am kind of curious to see how well those would do with just over the top aggressive feeding. Okay, number 98. This is a maroon Favites. It's getting a little bit of the separation of the reds and greens, but there's definitely punchier ones. Okay, next up, number 99. And G. Cunningham. Actually, I did. Yeah, I had a French 75. Yeah. I had that. I had Manhattan. I've had some other drinks there, like a Blackbird. I think that was what it was called. But yeah, they're all like super historic, like really old-timer drinks. But a French 75 is pretty awesome, actually. One of these days, I'm just going to take my friends and I'll just get in like an Uber, and just so none of us have to drive back and just go there for an evening. The other cool thing about that place is that they have like jazz musicians, and it turns out that like some of those jazz musicians like played with Coltrane and stuff. So they're like really, really legit musicians. All right, number 100. This is the Event Horizon Favia. So while the Dragon Soul was probably Robbie's favorite, this might be my favorite Favia. So next up, we have an Orchid Favites, Orchid Favites, number 101. Okay, next up, 102. It's the White-Eyed Favia. Is it me, or is that like really bright?
That's with the blue fluorescent.
Okay. What's it look like without? Oh, wow. Yeah. Pretty different. Event Horizon, Vigar Stun. That's funny. 103 is a Green Leptastria. By the way, SK Telecom is going to win 2016 again. I'm going to call it right. I'm calling my shot right now. January 16th. I'm calling it. It's gonna be the dynasty. All right. Next up, 104 is the Orange Leptastria.
Can you go back and Sebastian Goodfrey?
Sephastria growth rate. They're fast, like really fast. Once they get going, it's one of the faster stony corals, period, I would say. Oh, Zen 64, Cloud 9, I'm sorry. Well, actually, you know what? Okay, so I hate NALCS, okay? So sorry for those folks that aren't following this discussion. We're talking about League of Legends. When it comes to the NA, I like terrible teams. So I like Dignitas. They're total trash. They've been trash as long as I've been watching them. Like, I was watching them when they were good, when they had, like, Jat and Voyboy, like, that era of Dignitas, and they have been total trash since. And now I just, I almost exclusively watch LCK, that's the Korean. Is that the Korean league, LCK? Yeah, I almost exclusively watch that. So, yeah. NA is, like, so bad at League of Legends. Okay, next up, 105 is Yellow Leptastria. You can see how it has a much different fluorescence than the orange. Okay, 106. It will be pulsing Xeni in a second. What are the games do I watch? The only other game I really watch is like Hearthstone, and I kind of these days I get put to sleep by it, so I just turn on the video game streams and just go to bed. Terrapin, are there any Cynarina in the live sale? Unfortunately, no. They all are on the website currently, but none on the live stream. So when it comes to Xenia, it's kind of strange. Like, I'd say every single coral does better in the winter compared to the summer. Except Xenia, it still grows, but if you notice, it's not pulsing anymore. It pulses like furiously in the summer months, but not so much in the winter. And yeah, sorry Jonah, no Scullies, but there are a couple on the website. Next up, 107. It's a little Kenya tree. And no anemones, just because we're not able to show them properly. I'd have to basically take a short video or to just take a still image of them and just like pop it up temporarily, because they won't stay put. We set these corals up the night before, so usually what happens is that night they run away and we never find them again. So we have to kind of do something different for those guys. All right, next up, Neon Green Nephthia. Okay, 109. Actually, scoot over one. It's on my list, it's a blue Sympodium, so it's not that one. It's one more over, yeah. Somehow these two got switched places. So So 109 is the blue Sympodium. 110 is a red Discosoma, which I think is to the right. There's the red Discosoma. And it looks like there's three Zoanthids as well coming in. Those look like pink and golds. Yeah, I'm not sure how that got switched about. Okay. So scooting over two spots is the yellow Recordia Yuma. I know somebody was asking for Recordia earlier. These guys are pretty neat. What are Nephthia care requirements? Nothing really. I mean, they pretty much grow in anything. We did have one that took a while to start to get established, and it didn't really do much growing at all. And then suddenly it just like exploded in growth. So once they kind of get settled in, they just take off. You don't really have to do anything special for them. I've seen them grow in all different types of flow and light. Okay, next up, 112. No, when it comes to like determining their sex, there is a way to do it. I just haven't researched it at all. Somebody had shown me an article earlier. I just never actually got around to reading it. But yeah, there's some information on the web, certainly. Okay. Number 113. Okay, 113 is an orange Rhodactis. There's a ton of variety in like the size, colors, and texture of Rhodactis. And some of the most expensive corals nowadays are Rhodactis. None of these are that expensive, but there's some out there that are very expensive. Did I get those bounce mushrooms yet? Nope, not yet. One of these days, when they're no longer in demand, probably I'll get them. Let's see. How big of a tank do you need for a golden maxima? I'm not really sure. I've seen them in small tanks and big tanks, but I always recommend the bigger the tank, the better. 114. It's a purple Rhodactis. And you can see the size difference compared to 115, which is what we call an armored Rhodactis. Can you scoot the slider over just a little bit, Michael? There we go. So that guy's there is 115. Very different texture. It has those little, almost looks like Ghaniopora polyps on its face. Aw, thanks. Okay. 116. We're calling this an orange Recordia Yuma. It actually looks a lot more purple, but I think the fluorescence of the little bubbles is more orange. Yep. Have a good one, Louise. All right, next up, 117. It's a red spotted Discosoma. So I know that somebody was from, a couple people came from Germany, and I saw Texas, yeah. All over. Yeah. Okay, 118. It's the Yuma. So it's funny, like we call the other one an orange, and this one's seemingly more orange, but we call this one a purple. Hawaii. That's right, Hawaii. By the way, I was there not that long ago. I miss it already. Peru. I definitely want to visit Peru. Okay, next up, 119. Speckled Rhodactis. Netherlands. Yeah, I remember the Netherlands. And I definitely want to visit Sweden as well. Like, I need to go back to Europe in general. The last time I went to Europe, I was like a junior in high school or a sophomore in high school. That was a long time ago, let me tell you. All right, number 120, Speckled Rhodactis. For as much traveling as I like to do, I haven't been back to Europe. And the friend that I went to Velvet Tango Room with, he's actually like a bike tour guide that takes people on like bike tours and restaurant tours all throughout Europe. So he's like in Mallorca, Spain, and through Croatia, Italy, and stuff like that. So I definitely wanted to go do that one of these years. Again, when I can actually ride a bike and not fall over and die. And yes, I've actually been to London. So at one time or another, I was actually close-ish. However, the more I think about it, you might have been 5 years old at the time. Yeah, I'm so old. All right, next up, 121. Wintergreen Pipe Organ. What? I forgot something. Than can't ride a bike. I can ride a bike. My heart will not stay pumping long if I stay riding a bike. I have like a gerbil's cardiovascular system that has to somehow keep my 185 pounds of flubber alive long enough to do this live sale while eating sugar. It's a hard life. It's a hard life. All right, number 122. It's our first variety of green star polyps. These guys are kind of they're more wispy looking as compared to 123, which are the balloon varieties. So you can see that big white center. Pipe organ are similar to zinnia in care? No, not really. So pipe organ actually have a, not a skeleton base, but like, it's like a calcium, like a red calcium structure. And so they kind of need a little bit more flow, because sometimes what I've seen is like algae grows on that and kind of suffocates the polyps. So you kind of have to worry a little bit about that. Look at Gracie Diet I have, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu if you're serious about getting in shape. Funny you mention that, because Sean, also the personal trainer, also takes Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. And problem is, he's like a 250-pound black dude that would probably just kill the crap out of me as starting out into Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. But I'm thinking about actually having him help me with personal training. And at some point, I probably will just try rolling, because I don't really talk about this at all because it doesn't matter that much, but I actually have like a second degree black belt in two martial arts that don't help you in a fight. It's like Taekwondo and Karate. And if you know anything about the UFC, those aren't exactly popular martial arts that work. So, and I did those when I was like 18. So it hasn't been something I did for a really long time, but I would like to kind of get back into that at a really comfortable level, and jiu-jitsu might be that thing where I'm not taking like head kicks. But anyway, yeah, I could roll with Sean, except like I said, he's, he can deadlift like 750 pounds and bench press 500 pounds, and that's how I'm going to start into my jiu-jitsu foray. That sounds like a great time. So like suddenly you just don't see any more live sales. It's like, what happened? Yeah. I'm a blue belt at 10th Planet. That's where I'm getting all the reefer stuff out of you, Don Myers. I knew there was something. Oh, the heifer. All right, number 20, 125. Is that the second tricolor, Michael?
No, it's the first.
Okay, let's go to the second one, 125. Interstellar is the greatest space scientific movie. I might have to disagree with that. See, Bioastronaut, you walked into like film critic land. I might have to go with greatest space scientific movie. It's Alien, dude. Number one. Michael votes for Aliens. Because he likes commercial movies like James Cameron stuff. I'm kidding. Okay, let's go to 126. Dan's favorite movie is Fury Road. Wow, I don't know. I don't even know if that's my favorite movie this year. I'm kind of in love with Sicario. I love Sicario, and I don't think it got the Best Picture nod or anything, but it's fantastic. And I really liked Revenant, but it's not something I want to watch twice. Eddie Bravo handled Hoyler, for 20 minutes. Eddie Bravo, his stuff kind of works. I saw Metamorphosis 3, was it? Where he did, it was like him versus Hoyler 2. At no time did I think that Hoyler was winning that fight. Just gonna go and say that right there. So it ended in a tie, but whatever. I know who won that fight. 127 is Red and Purple Blastowelsi. So, for all you curious, Blastowelsis, they grow multiple polyps at their base. So you go from like one polyp to like six polyps very, very quickly. They also like low light. You can feed them. Let's see. The max size on the Redactus? Redactus is like the orange Redactuses usually get to be about, you know, 2 inches max of that variety. Do you target feed your Blastos? Yes, we do. Did anybody hear about the Star Wars Force Awakens movie poster passed up Avatar? Movie passed up at. Yeah, did hear that. Human Centipede is the best medical movie ever. I get the joke, Ray Miller Ray, but might have to go with Andromeda Strain there, buddy. Just gonna throw that out there. 128. Let's see. Yeah, Star Wars makes a lot of money. Something, something, Gracie Jiu-Jitsu. You know, I'll tell you what. The latest generation of Gracie seem a lot cooler than the previous generation. Like Henner and Heron and Kron. They seem like really, really cool. Whereas I think that like a lot of the ultra-competitive, super egotistical ones were like the previous generation. Like Horion and Hoyler, Hoyce. So I guess like all the issues that I ever had with like Gracie Jiu-Jitsu was just kind of like the sons of Helio. But then like after that, it seems like they're like the coolest people. All right, number 129 is the Red Blaster Merletti. None of them have the work ethic of their daddy and uncles. Might be true. Whoa, these things, Hannah and Huron, are ruining it. Wow. No love. All right. 130. We have a cosmic chalice. Okay, the online belt system is nonsense. I agree with that, Mr. Silent. That's, I think belt systems in general kind of wacky. 131, Civil War Chalice. This is currently my favorite chalice. We only have like a couple pieces of this left. Yeah, Don Myers, there's an online belt system. That's a thing. So this is one of the corals that unfortunately we lost a lot of when I got back from vacation. I guess like our large, huge, what you see is what you get colony of it, like somehow tipped over and like fell on its face, and nobody like noticed for like probably a while, and so it just died off. So we only have a couple pieces of this left. Oh, just how to do this?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So, I just have to remember that we were on 132. So, real quick, here are the rules. I know. I have to kind of go over some of this for some of the new people that have come in and don't know what the hell is going on. It's like we're talking about Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and stuff. Like, what is this? What kind of... What? Human centipede? And okay, so you can watch the obviously you can watch the show here on YouTube or on our page on TidalGardens.com. To actually purchase coral, you have to be on TidalGardens.com, and you'll see like a numbered list. It should go up to 174, and you know, we're covering the corals one at a time. If you like something, you can just put in your shopping cart and check out, and you can mix and match with stuff that's just regularly on our website versus what's on the live sale. And when you do check out, though, always select local pickup / live sale, because the you might have to be placing multiple orders because to actually reserve the item, you have to check out with it. Just putting it into your shopping cart doesn't actually do anything. So just make sure that by the time that you're ready to fully check out and you're done, make sure that you've at least paid for shipping once. If you happen to accidentally double up on shipping, don't worry about it. We refund that. And shipping for orders over 250 is free. So if you, you know, buy up a whole bunch, add in shipping once, and then you go back over it later with a couple more orders later, don't worry about it. We'll refund you. So that, in a nutshell, is it. Okay. Sorry to ask again. Is it unhealthy for coral to turn brown due to high nutrients? I recently switched skimmer, and while the skimmer breaks in, a lot of my SPS turned brownish. Here's the thing. Like, this is a specific thing to the hobby. People think when something turns brown, it's a bad thing. Like, people need to dive more. When you go diving, everything is brown. Like, I would say that, like, 80% of the coral looks brown. And it's not necessarily a bad thing. You know, we see like incredible, crazy coloration, and we assume that's what healthy looks like. It might not actually be healthy. It might be a pretty extended stress reaction to what kind of systems that we're putting together. But we're encouraged to build these systems because we like the way that coral looks. Not necessarily that coral is healthy. So sometimes when you have like corals turning brown, it's like an adjustment period for them before they regain a different type of coloration as they kind of fully maximize what it is to grow under your conditions. But just because it's turning brown, it isn't necessarily a sign of bad news. So there's that. Does a Civil War chalice grow in similar fashion to plating Monty? Similar, but much slower. Oh, and yeah, Bioastronaut, congratulations, like, welcome to the show. We talk about different stuff all the time. I spend probably only like a quarter of the time actually talking about coral. Okay. Sorry, I had to check chat occasionally. All right, we were at 132 to 130. Okay, so now we're on number 133. This is a blue moon chalice. One thing is, this guy is actually the second blue moon chalice that we've put up today. The first one that we placed yesterday rolled over and touched the Civil War chalice, and the Civil War chalice promptly killed it. So this is blue moon chalice number 2. All right, 134. No, 133 is a blue. Okay, now I'm confused. Could you go back one? Okay, I'm sorry. This is a lunar chalice. 132 is a lunar chalice. 133 is a blue moon chalice. So let's go to the next one again. Okay, I'm getting confused. I'm growing a little senile here. It actually looks like two chalices got fused into one here. All right, next up, 134 is a convict chalice. So all these chalices, if you notice, one thing in common is that they're all extremely different from one another. Chalices, like, they make up a huge, diverse category of corals. And unfortunately, you can't really infer a whole heck of a lot. Like, some are, like, plating. So the previous one, that blue moon chalice, plates pretty much like a Montipora. I think if you saw one in a tank, you'd say, hey, that's a nice, cool blue Montipora, but it's really a chalice. This guy here grows more like a boulder, grows a lot more slowly. The other one might grow 10 times that fast. Okay. Next up, 135. Number 135. This is a mystery chalice. This is probably the best looking chalice that we have on stream. Like I said, the Civil War chalice is my favorite, but this one might be the best looking today. Oh yeah, see, you guys are very lucky. Like right now, it's Robbie. That's moderating chat. Robbie doesn't ban anybody. Whereas like my friend's wife, Suzanne, she banned like 4 people in the one day that she did it. Like, we have like the zero tolerance policy in stream. So, you know, whenever people do troll the stream, we do kind of ban them. And we don't do timeouts. We just straight ban people. So. Yeah, have you banned anybody? Nobody's been banned today. All right. I'm disappointed again that nobody's been banned yet. All right, next up, 136. We're getting there. Hollywood Stunner chalice. And we have 5 of these. Yeah, it was a good stream. It was a good time. That's the first drunk stream. Next up, 137. It's the Insane Carnival Chalice. Okay. Next up, number 138, it's a lithophyllan chalice. Of all the different chalices, the lithophyllan is probably the most unique to itself. It's more like a fungi of plate coral than it is a chalice. Hollywood Stunners are plating. Daniel Hellenquist. How many pieces are coming on this stream? 174, I think, is the total. Kevin, how to get banned? Watch some of our previous streams, and you'll see. Usually super racist stuff. That'll do it. Yeah, I forget what people get banned for, but we found some pretty hilarious. See, the thing is, like, people think that, like, I get, like, all sensitive about banning people. It's not about me being sensitive. It's purely for the chat experience. I actually think a lot of that stuff is funny, but we just don't allow it to continue. That's all. Okay. Next up, number 139. You know what's weird? So if two of my chalices touch, they kill each other immediately. I've seen in other tanks, they're like sitting right on top of each other and nothing's happening. And it's like, I know that if I did that in my tank, both of those would be dead. So play it safe. I wouldn't mess with it. Nothing funny about racist stuff. We all bleed red. I don't know. There's some funny racist stuff. But, I mean, okay. I know I've said this before, but somebody got banned when they said, I probably eat dogs. You know, because, I guess Koreans or something might eat dogs. So I guess that's a thing, cats and dogs. I thought that was funny. I thought that was kind of creative, but he got banned. All right, 140. Okay. Yeah. No, so I wouldn't recommend being like a racist on this stream because it'll limit your ability to participate, let's just say. But yeah. It's like I've been a YouTuber now. I guess I'm a YouTuber. I've been doing this for like a while. So you grow a pretty thick skin about a lot of stuff over time. We also had somebody whose account was like named ISIS that said some crazy stuff. He got banned. We had the Ku Klux Klan jump in, saying some stuff. They got banned. Oh, yeah, I don't know. So there's some troll got banned. That's a tough one. Like we've got some bad experience with non-photosynthetic. Like the ones that have had the best experience with non-photosynthetics basically feed so much that it's insane. Like they basically, as soon as they have the tank at their office, and every time they walk past it and look at it, they feed it. It's an insane amount of food. Okay, let's move on. Number 141. Pink spotted chalice, 50. I have a chicken, a rooster, actually, and named it Zoanthide. Somebody was trying to convince me to get chickens. I don't know why. That's totally random. Okay, next up, 142. Oh, I know, Kyle. Like, I hired a full-time person named Kyle, and he's really, really big into chickens and roosters and stuff. Next up, 143. I was, like, really surprised at how cheap, like, chickens are. Like, they're, like, $4. You know, like, look at this. This is a pink and green chalice. It's $30. You could get, like, a lot of chickens for $30. I had no idea. Okay, 144. I don't know what this is called. So, I don't even remember what this guy turns into. He's kind of got a lot of purple going on, but then at the center is like red and teal. Okay, number 145 is a golden eye chalice. It's like bright red with yellow polyps. So yeah, if anybody wants to stop by here, we don't actually have any open hours. So everything is by appointment. Best way to get in touch with us is probably email. Sometimes the phone, it's like the phone number listed, it just goes straight to my cell, which may or may not have any batteries. So email, still the best way. We'll set up an appointment. Usually flexible, except if you want to do something during a live sale, that's not going to happen. Okay, number 146. This is a Hills Have Eyes chalice. Okay, next up, 147. This is a metallic zoa. Okay, here's a fair warning. These zoas may or may not be open. They were really kind of temperamental this morning, so some of them may be not that happy, but we'll see. Hopefully they are. And I don't know the names of all of them either. I've like forgotten so many zoanthid names. So if you do know what they are, post it in chat. Go crazy. All right, 148. These are the orange blowpop zoas. I think the rest of all of these guys might just be zoas, so we could just blow through these guys. Okay, 149. This is a pumpkin patch zoa. And we're trying to keep the price point down on many of these, because we are just trying to like clear out some space, because I want to focus on growing on some that really kind of excite me. 150 are the peach pallies. So pallies versus zoanthids, I'm kind of unclear as to when zoas end and pallies begin. I mean, there's some really, really obvious ones, but then we have some of these tweeners. So some of the ones with like the larger polyps, I tend to now call pallies, even though they might actually be zoas. They're very likely zoas, but also it depends on what Google search has the most results for, too. Not very scientific, I must say. Any Polythoa grandis? No, unfortunately. We only have like 3 polyps of that right now. Excuse me. Yeah, we literally have like 3 polyps of grandis. All right, 151. These are some lunar eclipse pallies. Again, probably zoa, but more commonly known as a pally. Next up, 152. This is a combo zoa slash pally of radioactive dragon eyes and purple death. And next up, 153. It's a combo of eagle eyes and jack frost pallies. You can kind of see the eagle eyes tucked in there a little bit. $10. I'm not out of candy. I'm just like, I'm out of diabetes. 154. These are 3 polyp rastas. Yeah, this is the speed round, isn't it? 155 are some Fruit Loops. You know, I actually had written down some announcements. Here's an announcement that I probably should have let you know. So corals look great in the wintertime. Problem is, winter doesn't always accommodate shipping schedules. So this coming Monday is supposed to be freezing icy cold. And when it gets down to like single digits here, we don't like to ship. So very likely we're talking about Tuesday, Wednesday shipments for all this stuff. Hopefully that's not an issue for you guys. But yeah, Monday going out is probably going to be a poor idea. So anyways, everybody that's been placing orders, we set up shipping dates through email. We'll get all that worked out. But like I said, Monday, not likely to be shipping out here. It's like I can just feel the temperature dropping like every hour that goes by here. It's chilly. And Robbie didn't bring a coat because it's, January 16th, and I guess you don't need coats. All right. Next up, 156. Rainbow Zoas. Okay. 157. These are some Sunny D's, which look a lot like Rainbow Zoas to me. This probably has like 1, 2, 3, 4, maybe like 5 polyps total. Okay. Next up, 159. Yeah, I don't know what these guys are called. They look a lot like some of the ones that we had earlier, like the blow pop variety. This guy's got a green skirt. Can we see that without the flashlight? See what that looks like? Yeah, like a lot more neutral. Yeah, tough to say. All right, what number was that?
158.
That was 158. Oh. Okay, so I'm sorry. 158 was the Mango Zoas, I guess. You can tell I'm so into the names. I so love all these millions of names that I have to remember. And the worst part is, like, if this was just like a regular store, I could just kind of ignore it. But I have to type something into a website. I have to make a label, so I'm constantly faced with having to like deal with these names, and I literally have forgotten more names than I currently remember. Are you guys going to Lear? We might. Somebody here might. I personally may or may not go. Okay, 159. This is the one that I didn't know what they were. And I still don't. Okay, next up, 160. These are just these forest green pallies. If people are looking for like super easy, these guys are super easy. They're practically unkillable, and they're very easy to feed. They grow like crazy. Okay, let's take a look at 161. Some Kryptonite Zoas. Oh yes, and Robbie recently got engaged, so congrats to him, I guess.
Thank you.
I guess. If you're into that sort of thing. Okay, next up, 163. 162. I'm so goofed up now. 162. Okay. 163. Our cotton candy, Zoas. Do Zoa gardens cause a mixing of colors when they reproduce? I don't think so. I have seen stuff that looks like they're kind of combining, but it's so uncommon that it's not something that you can expect to happen. Okay, 165. Hybridization is what we're talking about. Like, hybridization is actually kind of an infrequent thing. Oh no, jeez, I'm so weird. Okay, so this is 164, correct? Candy apple greens.
Correct.
All right. Okay. Next, I'm showing like wrong labels all the time now. 165 is pink plasmas. Okay. These guys are, as far as like the Zoas go, are probably one of my top 10. They kind of have like a that pink splatter going, and they have like a green speckled rim. Tinder and alcohol. I don't know about that. All right, 166. Not really sure what these guys are. Maybe Zoas, maybe Pallies. They're kind of cool. That's kind of some pastel coloration going on. And they're large. All right, next up, 167. These are some fire and ice Zoas. Obviously for red and blue coloration. Almost done, you guys. Next up is another unnamed Zoa. So feel free to toss names on these guys if you're into that sort of thing. See, the weird thing is I don't even remember where we got many of these things. They've just been around, just kind of like taking up space here, so we're just trying to move a few in and out. Okay, next up, 169. These are mellow yellow Zoas. Those have really, really taken off in growth for us. And they've it's nice that they maintain like the bright yellow coloration. Okay, next up, 170. These are Purple Death Palaeothoas. The Trump Hair Coral, that's like the Free Care Pavona. Yeah. Okay, number 171. I used to know what these were called.
Cat eyes.
Cat eyes, perhaps? Yeah, I think they're cat eyes or something. All right. Three more to go. We've got the 172. These are rainbow Zoas. ...173 are Jack Frost Pallies. What's in the background? I'm not sure, I didn't see anything. It might just be another plug. of something. Like, they might have been swapped out, the ones that were closed. Like, I mentioned some of them were closed earlier. It might just be those that we just swapped it with one that might have looked nicer. Okay, last one. Number 20, or number 174, is $20. It's some orchid zoas. Okay. 174. Okay. So we did it. All done. That's 174 corals in less than 3 hours. So hope you guys enjoyed that. I'm like super... I'm on my sugar low now, I think. Yeah, so anyway, thank you all for joining us. Again, it seems like it's been a long time, but I guess it really has only been about a month. We haven't scheduled the February show just yet, but it's probably going to be towards the end of the month. And hopefully we'll have like a lot more different stuff. We're actually in the process of changing around a lot of things here. So we're... See, I was actually hoping to get our new tanks in before this live show so we can actually use them. But within the next couple weeks here, we're actually getting 5 new tanks. We did a 2016 video, kind of like an update on our systems and stuff, some of the reworkings we're doing. And we're still in the process of doing all that. So again, like we're getting like 5 new tanks. Hopefully we'll get all that installed and up and running. And by the time the next live show rolls around, we'll have even more capacity for more corals. And so we're probably going to be going shopping at a lot of different places and seeing what, you know, cool things we can find. So different stuff than you've been seeing lately. I mean, even though we did show like 170 something, you know, to us, we've seen so many of these things before. I would like to also kind of like find some new things because we're always on the lookout. So anyways, until next time, I hope you all had fun. So I will see you all later. Bye-bye.